So bioelectricity is not magic. It is not unique in the sense that there are probably, certainly out in the universe, there are probably other ways of doing what it does. But what it does here on Earth in living forms is something very interesting. It functions as a kind of cognitive glue. So when you have collective intelligence, you need to have policies and you need to have mechanisms for enabling competent individuals to merge together into a larger emergent individual that's going to do several things. First of all, the larger network, the larger level is going to distort the option space for the lower levels. So the parts are doing things that the parts do, but they're now doing it in a way that that is coherent with a much higher level story of what's going on, higher level goals, because their action landscape is bent. It's distorted by the larger level. Their perception, their energy landscape is distorted. So that collective is going to, that new self is going to have memories, goals, preferences, a cognitive like. That requires some very specific features, and there are a bunch of them. And one of the modalities that lets that happen, that lets the cognitive light cone scale, that lets the intelligence scale, is bioelectricity. So by taking cells and enabling them to be part of an electrical network, there are some really interesting larger level dynamics, which, you know, this is what we exploit in artificial neural networks, of course, right? This is about biology, and noticed this since the time of bacterial biofilms, that electricity is just a really good way for higher level selves to emerge and higher level computation to emerge. There are probably other ways of doing it, but here on Earth, bioelectricity tends to be the way to go.
Something I always wonder in conversations about our higher selves, lower selves, higher goals. How do we even say higher or lower when what we're talking about is such a vast landscape of goals or cognitive light cones in a higher dimensional space where the real number line is the only continuum that has an ordering to it? As soon as you have the complex numbers or R2 or R3, etc., you can't pick two points and say one is higher than another.
Yep.
Unless you implement other structure. So what is it that allows us to say higher or lower?
Bad vocabulary. You're 100% right. The only thing that matters here, because it doesn't necessarily mean the next level up is not necessarily smarter than the lower level, usually, but that doesn't guarantee that at all. Not necessarily bigger or smaller in physical scale. So the only thing I mean by, and we really don't have a great vocabulary yet for all this stuff, but the only thing I mean by higher is something akin to set membership. Just the fact that a tissue is made up of cells, and cells are made up of molecular networks. That's it. That's all I'm talking about. I'm not saying that it's bigger or more intelligent or more valuable. All I mean is that in this hierarchy, certain things are made up of other things. That's it. That's all I mean.
Earlier, when defining intelligence, I believe you said William James's was something about ability, but also means. So ability to generate multiple paths to a single goal. I don't know if it was also the ability to have multiple goals, but we can explore that. But let's pick out a goal. Then you can generate multiple paths to that goal, many ways of executing. But then you also, I believe you said the means too as well. Is that correct?
Yeah, the means in James's, at least the way I read him, in James, when he says means, he means the path. That is the path. A means to an end, right? It's a path that takes you to that end. So, you know, this is the kind of stuff we see in biology, just to give you an example. One thing that people often think when they hear me talk about the intelligence of development and so on, people often think I mean the complexity, right? Just the fact that you start from an egg and you end up with, I don't know, a salamander or something, that there's an increase in complexity. And then, you know, and then rightly people think, well, that's just, you know, there's lots of examples where simple rules give rise to complex outcomes. That's just emergent complexity. That's not intelligence. And they're right. That is not what I mean. That's not intelligence. What I mean by intelligence is the problem solving of the following kind. So let's say you have an egg belonging to a salamander. One of the tricks you can do is prevent it from dividing while the genetic material is copying, and so you end up with polyploid newts. So instead of 2n, you can have 4n, 5n, 6n, 8n, that kind of thing. Well, what happens when you do that? What happens is the cells get bigger in order to accommodate the extra genetic material, but the actual salamander stays the same size. So if you take a cross section, so let's say we take a cross section of a little tubule, a kidney tubule that runs to the kidneys. Normally, there's like 8 to 10 little cells that go in a circle to make that tubule, and then there's a lumen in the middle. So if you make the cells gigantic, the first thing you notice is that, well, first of all, having multiple copies of the genetic material, you still get a normal newt. So that's pretty amazing already. Second amazing thing is when the cells scale to the amount of genetic material, so the cells get larger. That's amazing. Then you find that, well, actually, since the cells are really big, there's only a few of them are now working together to make the exact same size tubule. So they scale the number of cells to make up for the aberrant size of the cell, right? That makes sense. And then the most amazing thing of all happens when you make truly gigantic cells. There's not even room for more than one. One cell will bend around itself, leaving a lumen in the middle. The reason that's amazing is that requires a different molecular mechanism. That's cytoskeletal bending, whereas before you had cell-to-cell communication. And so that kind of thing, right? So just think about this. You're a newt coming into the world. You have no idea. You can't count on how much genetic material you're going to have, how many cells you're going to have, what size cells you're going to have. What you do have is a bunch of cool tools at your disposal. You have cytoskeletal dynamics. You have gene regulatory networks. You have bioelectricity. You have all this stuff. And what you're able to do under totally novel circumstances is pick from your bag of tools to solve the problem. I go from an egg to, in morphospace, I take this journey from an egg to a proper newt. Not only can I not count on the environment being the same, I can't even count on my own parts being the same, right? Another way to call this attitude is beginner's mind. It's like you don't overtrain on your priors, on your evolutionary priors. You have a bag of tools, and you're not just a fixed solution. This is why I think evolution doesn't just produce solutions to specific environmental problems. It produces problem-solving agents that are able to use the tools they have. I mean, what's a better example of intelligence than something that can use the tools it has in novel ways to solve a problem it's never seen before? Right? Like that is a version of intelligence, and that's what is all over the place in biology. The ability to navigate these pathways, not only to avoid various barriers and so on, but to use the tools available to them in creative ways to solve the problem. And we see some of this in extremely minimal systems. It does not require a brain, doesn't even require cells. Very minimal systems have surprising problem-solving capacities. And this is why we should be extremely humble when we try to make claims about what something is or isn't, or what competencies it has. We are not yet good at recognizing those things. We do not have a mature science yet of knowing what the properties of any of this stuff is.
So the tricky part with this definition of intelligence, help me out with this, is that what we want to say is that it's conceivable that the kid from Saskatoon, the poor kid, is more intelligent than the rich kid from the Bay Area. So that's conceivable. But the rich kid has far more means, far more ability to achieve their goals. So if there was implementability within the path, so if we say, look, the ability to generate paths that are realizable is in part what defines the IQ or the intelligence. Well, the poor kid from Saskatoon has less raw material to play with to generate a path. So how do we avoid saying, unless you want to say, which I don't imagine you want to say, how do we avoid saying that the poor kid from Saskatoon is just by definition less intelligent by happenstance than the person from the Bay Area?
Yeah. The thing to keep in mind here is that estimates of intelligence, and I think all cognitive terms, so everything about all the words that people use, sentience, cognition, goal directedness, all of them, I think we have to remember that those are not objective properties of a given system. IQ is not the property of whatever system you're trying to gauge the IQ of. It is your guess, your best guess about what kind of problem solving you can expect out of that system. So it's as much about you as it is about the system. And we've shown this in our experiments a lot of times, that when people talk about certain kinds of developmental constraints, or they talk about the competency of tissues to do one thing or the other, it's much more about our own knowledge of the right stimuli and the right ways to communicate with that system, and not so much about the system itself. When you make an estimate of the intelligence of something, you are taking an IQ test yourself. All you're saying is, this is what I know in terms of, and this is what I can see in terms of what kind of problem solving I can see. And this applies to animals, this applies to AIs, this applies to humans in various economic environments. You know, the simple version of this is you show somebody a human brain and they say, that's a pretty awesome paperweight, and I can see that it can do, you know, at least action and hold down my papers against gravity, and that's all I think it can do. And somebody else says, oh, you've missed the whole thing, right? Like, this thing does all this other stuff. So I think that that type of mistake where A, we think that it's an objective property of the system, and B, that we think that we're good at determining what that is what bites us a lot when we're dealing with especially unconventional systems. So if someone, so to use your example, if someone looks at a kid with that environment and says, well, I don't think this kid has much intelligence, the problem isn't on the side of the kid. The problem is that somebody else might come along and says, oh, you don't get it. In a different environment, this kid would you know, exhibit all these amazing behaviors. The good news about all of this, and you know, I'm certainly not, it's not in my wheelhouse to comment on any of the kind of economic stuff or the sociology of it, but for the biology and for the computer science and so on, the good news is that all of these things are empirically testable. So when we come across a certain system, each of us is going to guess what is the problem space it's operating in, what are its goals, and what capabilities do we think it has to reach those goals, and then we do the experiment, and then we see who's right. That's the thing, that this is not a philosophical debate. This is absolutely experimental. So if you say, I don't think these cells have any intelligence, I think they're just a feed-forward emergent dynamics, and I think, oh no, I think they're actually minimizing or maximizing some particular thing, and they're clever about doing it, we do the experiment. We put a barrier in their place, in the, you know, between them and their goals, and we actually see, do they or do they not have the what I claimed to be their competency, and then we find out how much each of our views lets us discover the next best thing. So these are all empirically testable kinds of ideas.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.